what is loading standards? Now if you see here, this is a typical building where all these drawings and most of the materials are taken from N. Subramaniam book. You can see here, one second, okay, now you see here, this is a building which has one second. You can see this is a building which is situated on this soil on the foundation. Now there are various types of loads are involved in designing of a structure. What are the various loads that are involved? Now you see, you have a, suppose if your structure is located somewhere in Himalayan areas, you always have a snow, or in the foreign countries, most of the countries the snow is all the time there, so you have a snow, so snow load comes into the picture. Load, these are all wind pressure, so wind is acting here. This is a wind load. You have a rain or ice or snow that is falling on the particular structure, this is a partition build. This is a partition or a okay, these are all.
Sorry, your voice is not audible, sir.
Are you able to hear me now?
Yes, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir. You're able to hear me now? Okay. So, here is a impact load. Okay. So here is a vehicle hitting this partition or a wall that is called impact load. Generally, we are not designing any structure for the impact load and all. Ordinary residential building and all, we are not designing for impact load. And these are occupants in the building. Their load is called live load. I will discuss in detail what are these loads and all. These are the occupants in the building. So this load will come. Now in the floor, if there are some machine is fixed here, then you have that, let us say that machine is vibrating, that resonant load will come, and some other element which is including torsion in the torsion in the structure. So these are the thing that you have to account for while designing a structure. Okay, so and also you have a, you see here is a sunlight. Now sunlight is going to introduce a thermal loads into the wall, so walls gets heated up and things like that. And in addition, suppose if the earthquake is there, we will have a seismic load comes into the picture. Okay, so these are all the various loads you should be considering while designing any structure. In some cases, you may not have snow load, so obviously you will not design for snow load. And in some cases, let us say you are going to have a single story building with an inclined roof, then obviously this kind of resonant load, because in the inclined roof you will not be fixing very heavy items and all, so obviously these loads will not come. Okay, but a wind pressure, all other load will be coming to the picture. Now, what are the loadings? Okay, now are you able to hear me clearly? Anybody please answer, because I want to
go. Yes, sir.
Okay, now mute yourself, all of you mute yourself. Before designing any structural element, see, we are not designing a whole structure as it is. We will always design element by element. The element consists of footing, columns, beams, and slab. When you assemble all these things together, you get a structure. But a structure as a whole is not designed. You always design a structure as a structural element. So one has to determine various natural and man-made loads acting on them. Okay, natural loads are what? Like wind load, snow load, rain load, earthquake load, these are all natural loads. And man-made loads means like live loads and all the material that you'll be using on the, all this dead load also, these are all man-made loads acting on the structure. So these are the types of loads acting on the structure. One is types of gravity loads and lateral loads. Now what is gravity load? Gravity load is the load which is acting vertically downwards. So these are three types of the dead load, live load and snow load. These are the three types of loads which is called gravity loads: dead load, live load, snow load. And lateral loads are wind loads, because wind is always horizontally applied on the building. So it's wind load is a lateral load, earthquake load is also a lateral load, and other environmental loads are there that also can be considered as a lateral loads. So these are the various types of loads acting on the structure for which you should design the building. Okay. Now there are some indirect loads, that is a temperature difference. For example, suppose sun is very heavy, and obviously let us say you have put on AC inside the inside a particular room. So the wall is going to experience on one side cooling atmosphere and outside hot atmosphere. So there will, it will have some temperature difference. So that will have some indirect, it will induce an indirect load into the structure. And there is a settlement. For example, if there is a land settlement at the, suppose if a soil below the foundation is not compacted properly, or because of other reason, if soil goes down, that also will induce a indirect loads into the structure. And then shrinkage is mainly due to the temperature effect. Because of excessive heat or cold, you will have a shrinkage effect. These are the indirect loads. Now, how to take into all the loads? That is why that Indian standards gives for various types of loads, what should be the load that is, should be taken into account. You should remember this this code IS 875, which was in 1987, because came into picture. It gives different loading standards. First of all, IS 875 1987 part 1 gives you the dead loads. Dead load means, suppose let us say you have a brick of a dimension 10 cm by 10 cm by let us say 20 cm, right? Now if you know the unit weight of brick or the density of the brick, if you multiply the density of the brick with the volume of the brick, you will get the load. So that is how you calculate dead load. Dead load is always calculated by multiplying the unit weight and the volume. Okay. Next is live load. Live load is the load where it varies from type to type of building. For example, suppose if you have a very simple residential building, the live load will be very very less. Suppose if you have a big auditorium, then there will be lot of people will be assembled at one point, at any point of time, so you will have a lot of live load. So the live loads also varies from different application to application. Okay, so you can calculate dead load as unit weight multiplied by volume. That will give you dead load of any structure, any particular element. Okay, that are given for a different material. For all the construction material, you can easily find out dead load. This is part one. The density of different material, around 50 different materials are given, so you can see it. I will present you in some time. So in part two, it gives live loads. What should be the live load to be taken for different types of building? That also I will show you in a while. Part 3 deals with the wind loads. What suppose actually entire India is divided into 6 different wind zones. So depending upon where your location of the building is, correspondingly you have to take the wind load appropriate to that particular this one. Next you have snow load. Part 4 deals with snow load. Suppose if you are constructing building at this part of Andhra, obviously you will not consider snow load. And lastly, you have other special loads and combination of loads that are given in part 5. So many of the interview question or in quiz question, they will ask about IS standards for various different types of loads. So part one deals dead load, part two live load, part three wind loads, part four snow loads, and part five special loads and combination of loads. Now we are going to focus in this particular course not all these loads, only we are going to deal with dead load and we are going to deal with live load. Only we are going to design or analyze the structure only based on this dead load and live load, nothing else. Other thing you will be studying later in the further course, in the advanced courses you will be studying like earthquake and wind load and all. Now we will see what is dead load and live load and all. For example, what is dead load? Please remember this definition: loads of constant magnitude that remain in one position. So if a particular load is acting, if the load is constant throughout its life and that position of the load is also fixed, such a load is called dead load. For example, if you have a you are all sitting in any your house, right, and your floor is there and roof is there. Suppose in the roof is, it has a definite volume, right? Roof is it has a length, it has a width, it has a thickness. It is not going to change at all, and it is not going to change in position also. So those are called dead loads. Dead loads are the self weight of the particular structural element is called dead load. Is that clear? So loads of constant magnitude that remain in one position, that is called dead load. This includes the weight of the structure as well as other parts that are permanently attached to it. Suppose you are attaching some fixtures. It may be, let us say you brought a very huge machine which could be used for example in the industry and all. They will be installing very very heavy machines and all. So if it is permanently attached to the floor, any parts which are permanently attached, that also form as a dead load. Okay. Now this footing, column, beams, slabs, and walls, stairways, these are all the examples of dead load. Okay. All the structural elements will form a, its self weight will be a dead load. This is called dead load. But only thing you have to remember, these are the loads of constant magnitude and that remains in one position. Now what is live load? One second. Okay, now what is live load then? Loads that can change in magnitude and position is called live load. For example, suppose any occupant in the building, we are not, it is not that we are throughout our life we are going to sit at one place, right? We have bedroom, we have kitchen, we have living room, we have puja room, we have veranda. So we keep moving from one place to another place, right? We will never sit at one place for a long time. So our loads keep on changing. Today we have some load. Suppose even in a day itself, in a day itself, when you have not eaten anything, as soon as you get up, your weight will be less. But after your lunch and all, if you measure your weight, at least 1 or 2 kg must have increased. So your loads also keep on varying. So loads that can change in position as well as in magnitude, that is called live load, or another name for that is called imposed load. So loads of people, storage items, furniture that is not permanently fixed, these are all the examples of live load. So loads of people are occupant, storage items. Why storage item is in live load, why it is not in dead load? Anybody can answer why the storage item? For example, let us say you have bookshelf, you have filled it with the book, and we are calling that storage item. Or in your kitchen you have a storeroom and you are filling with all the ingredients for cooking item, groceries and other things. Why storage item is coming under the live load, why it is not dead load? Anybody? Any guess?
Take them, well, we can replace them.
Sorry?
Those are not words.
I could not hear you completely. Can you repeat?
Means we can take them from that place and we can replace them, or we can increase the load at that place, we can decrease that load. So.
Yeah, because in a storage item, you are as and when you are required, you are taking it out, and after using it, you are putting it back. If it is like a book stall and all, you are putting it back. In the kitchen and all, in groceries and all, you are taking it for to be used in cooking, and later on you are replaced with fresh stock. So anything which is not fixed in its position magnet, it all will lie load. Similarly, furniture not permanently fixed. For example, here in your classrooms and all, you have a desk for students to sit. That is, desk is not permanently fixed to the floor, so that also will form as a live load only. It is not as dead load unless it is permanently fixed. For example, in our library seminar hall where you attended this conference and all these things, those furnitures are fixed to the floor. That will form as a dead load. But furniture that are not fixed, that will form as a live load. So. For example, in a bridge, loads of traffic, cars running, so many vehicles are running. All those are called live load only. That is not dead load. Bridge itself, it can be considered as a dead load, but the vehicle that are moving on the bridge are live load. Now, hydrostatic pressure on dams. For example, obviously, the dam is a structure which is used to retain the water, and as and when required, you are releasing the water. So your hydrostatic pressure is going to keep on varying because it is gamma into H. The H will keep on varying depending upon your level of water. So obviously, the hydrostatic pressure on the dam also will form as a live load. And soil pressure on retaining wall. For example, when there is a rain, the water, the soil which is retained by the wall gets wet. So the wet soil will have a different density. Dry soil will have a different density. So that soil pressure also will act as a live load for the retaining walls. Now, what are some other loads? There are environment loads. Loads caused by the environments in which structure is located. These are called environment load. So all environment loads are not caused by gravity. Okay, these are not caused by gravity. Snow and ice. For example, if you have a inclined roof, snow can fall in any way. It's not the snow is going to fall only vertical direction. It can fall in any direction. Similarly, rain also will fall in any direction. Wind, these are all environment loads. Seismic or earthquake load, these are all environmental loads. Okay. So these are the three types of loads that we essentially consider while designing any structure. Okay. Now, listen, dead loads are given in you see here, weights of different building materials are given in IS 875 part 1. There are 55 different materials is given in table 1 of IS 875 part 1, and some of them is represented here. You should remember at least some of these values are very important. For example, brick masonry with cement mortar, CM means cement mortar, 1:4. 1 cement, 4 sand. That is cement mortar 1:4. You must have studied in your building construction materials. Brick masonry unit weight is 20 kilonewton per meter cube. Remember the units, 20 kilonewton per meter cube. Plain concrete, it is not reinforced concrete, plain cement concrete, the unit weight is 24 kilonewton per meter cube. Reinforced cement concrete, it is 25 kilonewton per meter cube. And stone masonry, cement mortar, steel is 78.5 kilonewton per meter cube, more than 3 times the weight of reinforced concrete. So reinforced concrete is 75 kilonewton per meter cube. Reinforcing steel is 78.5 kilonewton per meter cube. So almost 3 times the weights of concrete. And similarly, there are other things. Water, usually we take 9.81 all those things, but here that code says you can take it as a 10 kilonewton per meter cube. So 10 material is represented here. So like that, there are 55 different materials is given in table 1 of IS 875. These are all the unit weight of different construction materials that are often being used. So similarly, live load. Live load is given. These loads are different for different types of building, as I mentioned earlier. And these are given in IS 875 Part 2. I will show you some of the details here. So suppose if you are constructing a residential building, the live load will be 2 kN per meter square. Remember, your live load will be always represented by square area, kilonewton per meter square. Many times students make mistake, they write kilonewton per meter cube, just keep, because your dead load was in kilonewton per meter cube, because dead load you always calculate by multiplying the unit weight into volume. That is why dead weight, the weight density is given in kilonewton per meter cube. But live load is always given in terms of per unit area, so kilonewton per meter square. So if you are designing a residential building, it is 2 kilonewton per meter square. Office with a separate storage, 2.5 kilonewton per meter square. Office without separate storage, it is 4 kilonewton per meter square. Shops, classrooms, restaurants, theaters with fixed seatings, you have 4 kilonewton per meter square. Without fixed seating, you can keep on moving the seating arrangement, then it will be 5 kilonewton per meter square. Factories, warehouses, it can vary anywhere from 5 to 10 kilonewton per meter square. Now, bookstores and stock rooms in library, this is the highest one you can see. 10 kilonewton per meter square. That is the for library. If you are going to design a library building, you will be taking live load of 10 kilonewton per meter square. Like this, stairs, landings, balconies, not liable to overcrowding is 4. If it is liable to overcrowding, you will design for 5 kilonewton per meter square. So remember, IS 875 Part 2 gives a live load for various types of building. Build loads are given in IS 875 Part 3, and it is again produced 1987. Now, IS 875 provides the basic wind speed. Many times this question is asked in interview. Averaged over a short interval of 3 seconds, having a return period of 50 years at a height of 10 meter above ground level. So IS 875 Part 3 gives you 6 different wind zones, and the wind zones are calculated, the wind speed is calculated for 10 meter above the ground level. It is not at the ground, but 10 meter above the ground level, and that speed can occur once in a 50 years. The return period of 50 years means in 50 years, that wind speed can occur one time. That is the meaning of return period of 50 years at a height of 10 meter above the ground level. Okay, and that speed lasted for 3 seconds. Okay, so that is the wind speed. And the wind pressure acting on the structure depends on the following: velocity and density of air, height above the ground level. Suppose if your height of the building is too much, then your wind pressure will be heavy. As you go high in the air, altitude, wind pressure will be more. And the shape and aspect ratio of the building. Suppose if you have a circular building, the wind will be drifted off. But if you have a very flat building, you will have a very high wind pressure. And the topography of the surrounding ground surface. Suppose if you are inside a city where your building is surrounded with so many other buildings and your building height is less, obviously there will not be any wind speed on your particular structure. But in a place you are going to construct a building where there is no other structure around, only your structure is one, then it is going to experience enormous wind pressure. So topography of the surrounding ground surface also matters. And angle of wind attack, that also matters. And opening in the structure, if there is any open, if your building is completely solid, or if there is any opening in the wall where the wind is acting, that also wind pressure depends upon all these factors. Now, as I told you, all over India, this is separated or divided into 6 different wind zones. Here is given the highest wind speed is, remember the unit, 55 meter per second. That is humming in the Himalayan areas here, and also in the northeast monsoon part here. This is the highest wind speed region. And You see, 33 is the lowest one that is here, because these are all western gates and all these things. So here is a place where you will have a minimum wind speed, and you can see the rest of the zone: 55, 50, 47, 44, 39, and 33. Okay, so you have to, before constructing your building, you should know where is your location, and accordingly you have to take wind speed. Okay, so this is given in IS 875 Part 3. Okay, you can refer to it. Now see, this is a example of a structure collapse just because of wind load. This is the original structure. Just because of wind load, it is started completely collapsed. It's in from some other place. It's not here. The structures are designed for the actual load due to snow, or for the imposed load specified in IS 875 Part 2, whichever is more severe. So, if a snow load is severe, you will take snow load, or if your actual load is more severe, you will take actual load. So, mainly we are not bothered much about snow load, because our actual load is more or less will be heavier than the snow load. So automatically that will take into accounts of snow load also. These are to be considered in the mountainous region where the snow falls. Like for example, this is one, this is not Himalaya, it is somewhere in the foreign country. You can see how much snow is deposited here in this field. So in this region you will never see a flat roof, you will always see a inclined roof, so that after some time it can the snow can fall off on its own. Okay, now earthquake load. Earthquake load is given in a separate code. It is IS 1893-2002. Now earthquake causes the ground to shake violently in all direction, lasting for a few seconds. In moderate earthquake, if it is a moderate earthquake, the shaking will be there only for a few seconds, or for a few minutes in a very large earthquakes. So earthquake means it will completely shake your building. We have experienced many times while I was in IIT, many times, at least 3 or 4 times in 2-3 years I experienced earthquake load. Although it was very mild, one time students were writing the exam in a 6th or 7th floor, and at that time earthquake came. So everybody just left the exam hall, ran out to the common place. Then again the exam was reconducted, because it could be very severe if the structure is not designed properly. It could be a very, the consequence can be very severe. So earthquake also has to be taken into account. So now India, the seismic zone is divided like 2, 3, 4, 5. There are 5 different zones. And when will you take, at what time, this is given. If it is an irregular building, if the height is more than 40 meter, you will, that is what here. In regular building, it is more than 90 meter. So these are all, this thing, we are not going to go very detail, too depth, in depth detail in for this one, because we are not going to study. But you should know earthquake load is there. Now these are all in Bhuj earthquake in 2001. How the completely the load, this is a plane surface, and this has caused the load to road to completely disintegrate. And also you can see various type of failure during Bhuj earthquake in 2000 in Gujarat. You can find many figures like this in the internet. You can see it, how earthquake can be devastating. Okay, so these are all loading standards. Now so just to recapitulate, you have to design a structure for a dead load, because dead load is always there, because whenever you build a structure, that structural weight is going to be always, self weight going to be there. So you are going to have dead load, you are going to have a live load. Live load is definitely going to be there, because you are designing a structure for some functional use. As soon as there is a functional use, somebody is going to use, so there is a live load. And if your structure is located in a place where there is a very severe wind, or wind is pretty high, wind speed is very high, you are going to take into account of wind speed, and you are also going to take into account of earthquake load. So all these loads will come into place. Okay, and as I told you, IS 875 Part 1, Part 2, Part 3 will deal respectively with dead load, live load and wind load. Earthquake load is separately dealt in IS 1893-2002. So all these loads have to be considered while designing a structure. Okay, well, now these are the loads to be considered. Now how to design the structure? For example, you are able to see a screen with whiteboard?
Yes, sir.
Anybody please answer. Okay. For example, so far what you have studied in your, let us say you have a simply supported beam. Which is span, this beam has a span some L and it is subjected to W. You know maximum bending moment which will take place at the mid span is equal to W L square by 8, right? Everybody knows. If the load is fixed, this load is fixed and if this span is fixed, and mostly in all the structure, you will never have a, at least in the concrete and steel structure, you will never have a span varying. Span is always fixed, right? So this is fixed. If the load is fixed, your moment will never vary. So let us say L is equal to 3 meters and W is equal to 4 kilonewton per meter. So you have 4 square by 8, which is 6 kilonewton meter. No matter, suppose 100 students are answering this question, all the 100 students should get 6 kilonewton meter as the bending moment. Okay. You cannot get the different values for this load and for this span. The maximum bending in a simply supported beam is only 6 kilonewton meter. Okay, it cannot be any other answer. But if you are going to design this beam for this span and this load, you can have 100 different answer. I can design this beam in a particular way. You can design the beam in another particular way. Somebody else can design the same beam in some other way. So you can have a hundreds of design for the same beam. So design is always a varying thing, but analysis is always a fixed one. So if you are finding out the fixed bending moment or shear force for this structure, it is always constant. It will never vary. But if you are designing a structure, the design can be as many design as possible. It does not matter. You can have any number of design. So now how to design? Now that will be talked here, design philosophy. So there are some philosophies based on which you will design the structure. And the design philosophy is given by the code. And this design philosophy is arrived after many experimentation. They have worked for years and years and years, and then they brought the design philosophy. Now basically, what is design philosophy? First of all, let us discuss what is design philosophy. Then we will go into detail into what are the various different philosophies. The design of a structure, what do you mean by design of a structure? May be regarded as the process of selecting proper materials. If you are designing a structure, first of all, you have to choose a proper material and proportioned elements of the structure. Proportioned means size of the structure. You should also select the proper size of the structure to withstand the external load according to the art, engineering science and technology. Okay, so design means two things. One is selecting a proper material. Another was selecting a proper size. It could be the size means width, depth, length, all those stuff. Okay, so if you are designing a beam, obviously you will span of the beam is fixed. You will only design the cross section. What should be the width of the beam? What should be the depth of the beam? Similarly, if you are designing a slab, slab will cover the entire floor. So your length and width of the, for example, if you are designing a slab, let us say this is your slab. This is your room for which you have to lay a slab. Obviously, where this length is fixed, this width is fixed. Your slab should cover this entire area. Okay. only thing that you will, what you will be designing, you will be designing the thickness of the slab. What will be the thickness? So this is the thickness. So likewise, so proportional element means if you are designing a slab, you will be designing the thickness. If you are designing a beam, you will be designing the width and the depth. If you are designing the column, you will be designing the cross sectional dimension, because height of the column will be fixed. Okay, this is called design. Now, in order to fulfill its purpose, the structure must meet its condition of safety, serviceability, economy, and functionality. There are four things. Whenever you design a structure should be completely safe. It should be able to withstand all kinds of load for which it is designed. It should be serviceability means it should be usable. Okay, we will discuss in a while what the serviceability means, and it should be economical, and it should perform its functionality. Okay, functionality and serviceability is interrelated. Safety, economy, serviceability, and functionality. It should meet all these requirements. That is the design. Okay, now four design philosophy. Okay, first one is a working stress method. In short, it is called WSM. It was developed during 1900. Okay, we will discuss all this thing in detail in a while. So first method was working stress method. In 1900 it was developed. Next was ultimate load method, which in short it's called ULM, which came into existence in 1956. It has this method has some advantages, and there are some inherent disadvantages as well. Similarly, ultimate load method also has its inherent disadvantages or demerits. So in order to overcome the disadvantages of working stress method as well as ultimate load method, there was one new method developed that is called limit state method. In short, it is called LSM, limit state method. It came in 1978 into practice in India. So in this particular course, we are just going to introduce about what is working stress method, what is ultimate load method, but we are going to discuss in detail about limit state method. So we are going to discuss only about limit state method. All the analysis and design will be performed based on limit state method, working stress method, ultimate load method. You will be given just the concept of it, what is the concept and where it was used, and so on and so forth. This ultimate load method is a completely obsolete method. It is not at all being used right now, but working stress methods are used still in designing of very important structures. So that we will see which are the structure which are designed based on working stress method even now. Okay, is that clear? Working stress method, that was the first one. Then ultimate load method, that came second. Then to overcome the demerits of working stress method and ultimate load method, you have a limit state method. Now we will see one by one working stress method. What is working stress method? Now this concept of design, not only for half a means reinforced concrete, but also for a structural steel and timber design. Many structures in earlier time was designed, for example, if you see most of the railway structures and all in the railway station earlier, you will see all the structures are mostly made of steel only. If you could see the water tank and the shed, everything was made of steel only. So earlier times, all the building made of steel and timber, and also RCC was designed based on working stress method only. Now, what are the various assumptions made in working stress method for the design of structure? This is the most important assumption, that the structural material behaves in a linear elastic manner. Linear elastic manner. This is the most important assumption made in working stress method. And second one, both the steel reinforcement as well as concrete act together and are perfectly elastic at all stages. See, although we say concrete is a brittle material, but we are in a working stress method, each and every material, whether it's a steel or it's a concrete, it is always assumed that the material is behaving in a linear elastic manner. We will discuss what is this linear elastic manner in a few minutes. Now, modular ratio can be used to determine the stresses in steel and concrete. This also I will explain. Now, permissible stresses are kept well below the material strength. In working stress method, permissible stresses are kept well below the material strength. And what is permissible strength? What is this permissible stress? Permissible stress is called ultimate stress or yield stress. Okay. If you are using a brittle material, you will take ultimate stress. If you are using ductile material, for example, if you are finding out steel, permissible stress in a steel will be yield stress divided by factor of safety. Permissible stress in a concrete is ultimate stress divided by factor of safety. That is called permissible stress. Okay, and these stresses are kept well below the material strength. Okay, now factor of safety in working stress method, for a steel it is 1.78, for a concrete it is 3. I am going to show you how these values have come. For a steel, factor of safety is 1.78, and so it varies from 1.78 to 1.92 actually. For concrete it is 3. Okay, let's say you have a stress strain curve of a steel, and this steel is Fe 500 steel. Okay, so I'll take a pen. So this is a Fe 500 steel. Fe 500 means your yield strength is at this level. It's this value is 500 MPa. Okay. Now, say instead of this steel, let us say I will take about this one here. Okay. This is a mild steel. This is a stress strain curve of mild steel. All of you listen carefully. You have a linear region here. You have this region here. If you see the stress strain curve, it is only linear, straight line linear. If you load the structure steel up to here, and if you unload it, it goes back to original position. Okay, so up to this point, it is called up to point A. It is called elastic limit. Elastic may be here also. It is called proportionality limit or linear limit. Okay. So up to here, your stress is proportional to strain. Okay, stress is proportional to strain. After that, you have a non-linear. These are all non-linear part. In working stress method, although this is your strength of the steel, this will be, let us say, this is your Fe. This is the ultimate strength of the steel, Fu. And this is the yield strength. This is the yield strength of steel. This point is a yield strength, that is called yield stress. And this proportional limit is less than this. Now, in working stress method, both for the steel as well as for the concrete, you will only take only the elastic region. This is all elastic region. This region is called elastic region, because what is elastic region? You load a particular element in elastic region. After that, if you unload it, it will come back to its original position. That is called elastic one. Okay. Now, what you call linear elastic? That means, suppose let us say you take some other material, something like this. Let us say it is elastic up to here. You load it up to here, and you unload it, it will come back to original position. It will retain its original position. But these are all non-linear part. But in working stress method, only the linear, let us say this is linear up to here. Up to here it's a linear. So only this much stress is taken in working stress method material. Okay. So in working stress method, only linear portion and that too elastic portion only alone is taken as a maximum permissible stress. So permissible stress is limited up to this one. Although your steel can take this much strength, you are limiting the steel only up to this much. So this much strength you are wasting it. Okay, this much you are not making use of it. So that is working stress method. So here, okay, so this is the Fe 500. Here also the allowable stress is, although it can take 500 newton per millimeter square, but in working stress method you will take maximum strength of the steel is only 280 for Fe 500. So if you are using Fe 415, for example Fe 415, the maximum strength is 415 divided by 1.78. similarly, if you are using Fe 250 steel, you will take 250 divided by 1.78. So these data are given. One second. This is IS 456, which I am going to show you. In this, if you just go to 200 page. Okay, this is working stress method. Annexure B is a working stress method. So you can see working stress method here. Here is C, right? This working stress method. Now permissible stresses in concrete, here it is mentioned. Are you able to see the screen properly? Permissible stresses, yes, in concrete here. Okay, now these are the grade of concrete in the, here whatever you see, M10, M15, M20, M25, these are all called grade of concrete. What is grade of concrete means? Yesterday I discussed, M10 means mix 10. That means at the end of 28 days of curing of concrete, if you test the material, it will give you a strength of, compressive strength of 10 newton per millimeter square. That is called grade of concrete. So permissible stress in compression, bending compression, it is for M10 it is 3. For M15 it is 5, for M20 it is 7. So what is the ratio between this 3 and 10 and 5 and 15, 20 and 7? If you see, it is almost 3, right? 15 by 5, how much? 3. 10 by 3 is 3.333 or something like that. So 20 by 7 is almost 2.89 or 2.9 something. So this is how in a working stress method, although your concrete, for M10 concrete can resist a value of 10 newton per millimeter square, but you will take only 3 because factor of safety you are assuming 3. That is why in working stress method the factor of safety for concrete is 3. This is regarding concrete. So regarding steel, so similarly, if you see M30, in bending compression the value is only 10. 1/3 of 30 is 10. Similarly, this is a direct compression. For example, this bending compression you will design, you will be using for designing a beam or slab. If you are using direct compression, if you are designing a column, column is a direct compression member, you will use this one. So factor of safety for a direct compression is 4. See, this is a M10 and this is only 2.5. So 10 divided by 4 is 2.5. Similarly, almost 15 divided by 4 is almost again close to 3 point something, 3.89 or something like that. That is also 4. 20 divided by 5, that is also 4. So factor of safety of concrete in direct compression in working stress method is 4. Factor of safety of concrete in bending compression is 3. Now for the steel, you can see at the bottom here. Permissible stress in steel reinforcement here. Mild steel bar and this is a high yield stick bar, Fe415 and all. So if it is the diameter is up to 20 mm, it is 140 is given. Mild steel means what is the value of yield strength for mild steel? Mild steel is Fe250. What is the mean by 250? Means 250 is the yield strength of the material. Okay, so 250 divided by 140 EPC, you will get around 1.78. That is why it has arrived. And similarly here, Fe415 steel, the if a diameter is up to 20 mm in tension, the maximum tensile stress in the steel is 230 newton per millimeter square. Okay, so factor of safety is for steel 1.78, for concrete it is 3 in working stress method. Now the you can use concept of strain compatibility here. How will you find out strain and stresses in steel and concrete? There exists a perfect bond between concrete and steel, because essentially concrete is a composite material. You have a concrete as well as a reinforcement steel. It is assumed that there is a perfect bond between concrete and steel, and strain developed in steel under the surrounding concrete at any load is equal. Suppose you see, okay, in a while you will understand better. Right now it may be little abstract for you, but we'll go further into the topic, you will understand all this thing more nicely. Now stresses in steel is indirectly related to the stress in concrete. So as I told you, working stress method is completely linear elastic method only. All the materials behave only elastically, and that too linearly. So stresses, strain in the steel and the surrounding concrete is always same. Stress in the steel can be indirectly related to stress in surrounding concrete. So stress in steel is equal to modular ratio multiplied by the stress in concrete. And what is this modular ratio? Modular ratio is modulus of Young's modulus of steel divided by Young's modulus of concrete. This method, that is why is called also modular ratio method. Okay, now you know Young's modulus of steel is 2 into 10 power 5 newton per millimeter square. Young's modulus of concrete is how much? I told you yesterday. You see, if in your this one, go to page maybe 20.
5000
into root over FCK.
Yeah, exactly. Very good. So 5000 under root FCK. This FCK means characteristic compressive strength. That is, if you have M25, this FCK value is 25 newton per millimeter square. So 5000 under root 25 will become 5 in this is, let us say, root 25. Root 25 is 5. So 5 into 5000 25000. So that is called a modular ratio. So if you know stress in concrete, yes
sir, FCK 25 by factor of safety, sir.
No, while calculating the modular ratio, Young's modulus, you will not apply factor of safety. Okay, because this is given in the code itself. If you see the code here, Young's modulus of concrete is 5000 root FCK, where root FCK is, EC is the short term elastic modulus in elasticity. If FCK is taken as it is, you cannot use the factor of safety. Factor of safety will use later on in the design. Okay, I will let you know when to use factor of safety. Okay, now almost time is going to be up, so we will stop with here. Now I want to know, is there any question? Anybody have any question, any doubt? In the next class onwards, we will keep some time for question, because I did not realize that time is going to be up. So is there any question for anybody?
Sir, concrete ki factor of safety 3 endu teeskunna sir, steel ki 1.7 ga teeskunna.
For concrete it is 3, and for steel it is 1.78 in working stress method, because steel is made in the factory. So you can make a very quality control is maintained very well in the factory. So because it is a factory product, the uncertainty in the material property is very less. But whereas concrete is handled by all kinds of people, and the number of materials involved in making concrete also many more, like cement is there, fine aggregate is there, coarse aggregate is there, and every time you can have a different fine aggregate, different coarse aggregate. Because of the variation in so many different material properties, you have a higher factor of safety in concrete. Suppose that is why if your manufacturer say my concrete has a grade of 50 MPa, you will not take 50 MPa in your design. You will take only half of that or one third of that, because many factors are involved in making concrete. So we will try to avoid taking full value. Okay, that is why concrete will always have a higher factor of safety than steel. Is that clear?
Okay, sir.